In the spring of 1997, I asked my wife, would it be okay if I would apply for a job anywhere in the country, Sweden? I didn't dare to ask about Norway, so I asked about Sweden. Actually, I had asked her about Canada earlier, but I thought that was no good idea. And then she asked, well, in a way, but there are many jobs here in Göteborg. Just look at the press and the newspaper. So there were a lot of jobs as teachers in Göteborg. Yes, you see, I said, I've been many years at the Chalmers University of Technology. I've been playing as a musician around in Europe. I've been a consultant and more. So I thought that I would like to see a school that is serious about the curriculum. And then we thought that we should try. Is it the wrong direction? Ah. You should speak with your heart. All right. And we found a beautiful place. I got in contact with a school in Storuman. And people in Göteborg, our friends, said, look, they are moving to Lapland of all places. And if you look into the research, you can also see that rural areas, we have no clear definition. The only definition that everybody seems to agree about is that it's outside. It's outside modernity, it's outside the postmodern city, and it's outside history, because the history is the move to the city and to specialize and everything like that. So I didn't know what to expect, actually. So I tried. Maybe I should try a salary demand and see if they could solve it. And because I had dealt with physics and chemistry and mathematics, I thought this is some of my competences. So I sent that salary demand, and I was surprised because the principal who was hiring me, he was a PhD in sports medicine. He couldn't solve this equation, so I had to solve it. And then he called me back and said, well, this was very interesting. Everything was good, but not your salary demand. I think it's too low. Would you accept 200 euros more per month? Yes, I won't mind, I said. And then I got to work at the Luspen Gymnasiet, at the senior secondary high school, and it was very interesting because they had a lot of things going on that were really high quality, and I won't have time to go into this right now, but I can speak to you afterwards if you are interested. But one of the most interesting things was that there was a research profile. So students were able to spend almost 20 weeks at the university or at the institution together with a professor or a senior lecturer and doing really sharp work. One of our supervisors at the university said, well, I would prefer your students to one of my PhD's students. So they did very good work. And then, just to make a long story short, I became a principal in Tärnaby. That's far up in the mountain towards the Norwegian border. And it was even a smaller society. And it was very many interest in skiing. Many of the world champions come from Tärnaby, actually. So I was at the very school of Ingemar Stenmark, Stigstrand, Anja Persson, and a lot of other skiers. Actually, Storuman municipality is one of the largest densities of world championship. It's one world medal per each 800 inhabitants. but what about the school then? What about the school? Well, I was shocked when the results came, because it was huge challenges. I was not very satisfied with the teachers, how they met the students. I thought it was not ethically right to address these issues that we are coming into here today. But anyway, there were some really good, highly qualified teachers when it comes to building good rapport with the teachers. And one of them educated the last class, grade 9, at the school. And they came out with very good results. So it was the best in the country, actually. Then they needed a school head in Sorsele. And this was the beginning of all the kind of problems that we are going to discuss today. You may wonder, is this the right conference? Because this is a large-scale community. It's the largest, among the largest 10 communities in Sweden, so to speak. But if you do the math, you can see that rounded to the nearest integer, it is 0 inhabitants per square kilometers. And in the EU context, you always want to round to integers, so don't have a lot of decimals, but it's actually 0.3 or 0.34. So that's a very, very, we talked earlier, what is rural, what is sparsely? This is sparsely. And there was huge challenges, because when you have such a sparse community, it's also scarce, and you have very little tax money and such things. Then it turned out, completely as a shock, that we were the third best school municipality in Sweden, and 2 years later, the very best. And I thought, this is just crazy. Is it really quality, or is it just some kind of artifact? It's according to the small law of numbers, that is so little that it can be very good, it could be equally bad the next year, and so on. So, and it came almost like an epiphany for me to see then that it was nothing bad with Sorsele, it was nothing bad with Storuman. But anyway, people didn't want to move there, and I wondered why. And then I started to realize that I just had happened to move from an urban environment to a place where these four megatrends were very much more clearly visible than I could ever imagine in the city. And I'm very thankful for that. Have you had breakfast today? You recognize this? What is it? Mango? You know what? My grandmother never had mango. She never tasted a piece of mango. Mango today is one of the world's most popular fruits. More than 100 countries exporting to 160 countries, about 50 million metric tons yearly. How could that be? Just a couple of generations ago, nobody in Sweden didn't know at all. This is just a simple example of how things are spreading. And because I was trained as a theoretical chemistry, I like to think about thermodynamics. Why doesn't my sound stay in my mouth? Why doesn't the radiation stay in the lamps? Why doesn't people stay in their place? Why doesn't the dirt stay in the corners? Why do I have to clean once in a while? Well, that's of course the second law of thermodynamics that says that it's much more probable that things will end up in all places if the barriers are lowered. So I like to connect globalization to that kind of trend, that when it's easy to transport things, they will be transported across. And also people are spreading. And we don't, even if we are spreading, not everything is equally distributed, so we like to cluster together. I think we started ahead of time, but now we're behind time. Yes. So I have to move faster. And the other big mega trend is the demographical transformation that most countries come into sooner or later. For example, in former East Germany, the women are postponing their pregnancy so long as it is practically forever, actually. So it's very low nativity. So we are moving from high fertility and high mortality to low fertility and low mortality. And the other reason is that we get older and older. Yes. And you can see that in south of Lapland, we are already very old. So we are among the oldest persons in the world. So therefore, we get an invitation from Japan, our previous boss last year, and so on. So in a way, you can say that our move to Storuman made us experience the future already now, because many predictions for the world 2050 is already true in our small-scale communities. Then there is these national challenges. We want well-being for all, not only in Göteborg or Stockholm or New York or Paris. We want well-being in Storuman and Sorsele and Faroe Islands. And we have a lot of legislation that says that we should have equal access to healthcare and such things. Every municipality is obliged to supervise at least 20 special laws, and that needs a lot of competencies in economics, technical issues, and schooling, and other things. It depends on the legislation how challenges will be. I won't go into this, but it says essentially that in order for a municipality to have an efficient schooling system, you need at least 10,000 inhabitants, as the system is set up right now. And we had 2,500 in Sorsele. So the national challenges become even more crucial for rural areas. Actually, because every right is going to be supplied, you need more specialists per capita than in an urban area, because you need specialists in all these areas, but there are so few people. So that means that people often have large responsibilities, there are mixed content in the employments, and there are also mixed roles. One of my teacher was also a parent at the same school. He was also a local leader in the church, in the association. He was also politicians deciding about the money for the municipality. And confidentiality is not easy, as it was very interesting to listen to Christy before. We have nurses who have confidentiality against themselves, because they work in different positions, and it should be professional secrecy, a border, but it's the same person. So it's not easy in a small scale, yes. So the basic question, how can we do that in small scale community? How can this girl get water, get education, get healthcare, and get all of this infrastructure that we are need? And the basic question for small scale communities is, how can they increase resources? And there have been a lot of talks. You can raise the tax, you can merge municipalities, you can discuss, do everybody have to have the same responsibilities? And I won't go into this, but it's a great debate in Sweden right now. So let's continue. I haven't time to tell you about digitalization, but I could have told you about how we built small digital health rooms. I've recently been a project leader for that. Okay, you have to interrupt me, Annette. Then in Sorsele, people wanted to grow the community. And one way was actually to receive a lot of refugees. So we had the most unaccompanied children per capita in Sweden some years ago. And we had the most quota refugees also per capita in Sweden. Approximately a third of our students in the school were refugees. And the ethical challenges comes mainly from that there's a lack of people and professionals. So we have, for example, 20 languages, but no interpreters. We had to call an interpreter in London, speak English. He translated back to Rohingya. And then in Somali people, they were not very fond of interpreters because they could be of a different clan. And if they hear what I'm saying, what about the situation for my relatives still in Somalia? And access to healthcare, we didn't have professionals to treat PTSD, and it's long distances, it's more than 200 kilometers away. And vaccination, they were very keen to vaccinate, but they didn't get the delegations from the doctor, so they had no vaccine, even if they wanted to do vaccination. So let's wrap up with just a short story. Imagine a young girl, 15 years old, in a burqa. She has just arrived from Somalia. She has never went to school. She didn't even know how to hold a pencil. And the teacher said, well, I could teach them if they only knew Swedish. And I was perplexed about that. So I thought, why don't I see that myself? So I went to the classroom. I practiced like crazy Somalian counting words the night before, because I thought that if I can only see if she has can understand the numbers from 0 to 10 and the what is called number sense, then she actually knows some mathematics. So I went to the classroom and we were able to discuss some numbers there. I won't have time to tell you about that. But the thing is that if you compare the different values, this is from the World Value Survey, where we have a picture in Sweden that we are lagom. A little in the middle, but you can see Sweden is the most extreme countries. So what happens when you meet people from another part of the world? And it was very interesting to look at these ethical issues, because if you think of the four criteria, personal autonomy, best for the patient, to avoid harm, justice, what does that mean if the family is the best to decide for your future? What does that mean for what is best for the patient? And what does justice mean when we have such scarce possibility of offering those services? So to finish, my thing, point of view is that actually I'm very thankful that we moved to very sparsely populated areas, because that has given us a rural vantage point. We have seen the future, because many places in the world is going in this direction, and we have seen that already. We have built services. So small-scale communities may be sparse and scarce, but not scared. And we can be strong and even stronger together. And we could connect, for example, like building these kind of small-scale communities, not only connected to the big cities, but connected to each other. And that's my vision. So thank you very much. And now you will hear the truth from my beloved wife since more than 40 years.